Next esteemed guest of the day is Mr. Vasudev Mahapatra, an independent journalist, editor, and documentarian based out of Bhubaneswar, capital of the eastern India state of Odisha. Vasudev Mahapatra specializes in environmental, science, and developmental journalism. He writes on biodiversity, ecosystem services, agriculture, food systems, health, nutrition, and sustainability in the wake of climate change. Working independently since September 2015, the last work as editor-in-chief of Odia TV news channel Nakshatra News. Before it, he was executive editor of an Odia Daily Aroma and state correspondent for Indian News Hindi and NewsX English channels. He is an active member of global professional associations like Society of Environmental Journalists and International Science Writers Association. His works have brought him Larky Media and Advertising Award for Gender Sensitivity 2017 for Best Gender Sensitive Web Feature in English from Eastern India, Media Excellence Award 2017 as Best Web Journalist of Odisha, and Odisha Media Award 2015 for Environmental Reporting. As a journalist and science communication professional, his primary argument is that SDGs on poverty, hunger, health, and education can be overcome and sustainability can be achieved by spreading scientific tempo in the society and dealing with all related issues collectively. It's an honor to have you as with us, sir. Over to you.
Thank you, Manav, for the elaborated introduction you gave about me. And I will, specially thank Mr. Anuj for, involve me in this conference. Bringing in to me to this conference, and my sincere regards to Dr. Alok Mishra ji and Dr. Bharti ji and Dr. Paritosh ji for being co-panelists here, and it's an honor actually to be here for me. So this particular subject has enormous importance at this point of time when actually the world is grappling with a pandemic that has actually taken the world into its own control. Everybody is inside their homes and no activities taking place. So it's like the world is won by a virus. The virus is ruling over the world. And this particular danger, actually, where from it came, why this danger came to us, when we, go deep into this question to find an answer, then we finally see that the environment, the environmental losses, environmental degradations, and, that has happened due to human interference over last, centuries, has resulted in the pandemic today. And experts are also predicting that such pandemics would be more frequent in future, maybe more stronger also, more critical than today. So at this point of time, discussing about the rights to nature instead of discussing about the rights of nature instead of our right to nature has bear enormous importance, has become more relevant than any time actually. So when actually we talk about environment, I would like to just speak a bit on how the environment works, how nature works, how life systems, how forest ecosystems and nature as a whole operates. So if you look at it, actually man happens to be a part of the nature, maybe one of the species among thousands of species around. Man, human being, is just sharing nature with other life systems, other animals, other plants, other ecosystems. So when you talk about nature, human nature relationship, if you see, the first thing is, I'd like to say, is plant. Animal and plant. So man is one of the animals. Plants are there. Plants, give everything to man, most of the things to man. It gives oxygen, it gives through fruits and other things. It gives lots of services like flowering and supporting honeybees, providing honey to man. So food and oxygen, you can say, if they are the major the services provided by the plants, they only thrive on the soil. So the soil is one of the important, very important part of the nature that actually you can say sustains the nature. Plants, animals, everything. It provides food, it provides water, it provides ecosystems, everything, ecosystem services and everything to man. And when we talk about soil, it actually also retains water. So water, it provides through rivers, water flows through rivers. We get water, underground water, through digging wells, ponds, and through tube wells. We extract water from the soil to survive. Then that water actually goes again to the ocean. So ocean actually gives us pieces, nutritional. Ocean is the largest food source for mankind. So ocean, gets water, it remains healthy when it gets sufficient fresh water from the through the rivers, from the runoff waters. So when the ocean, remains live, remains healthy, then it, provides us rain. Again, water comes through rain. That goes to soil again, that supports this plant, forest, ecosystem and humankind. So it actually is, it moves like a circle, and nature operates itself to support the whole system. And when we actually interfere in this system, and we interfere in each and every part of the system, say for example, since actually when man was just a hunter-gatherer, after it started agriculture, the primary change was land use change. So we started creating land for agriculture. We started ignoring forest as a part of our life, as an important part of our life, because we depended more on agriculture for our food. So our dependency in forest actually gradually came down, and then we started ignoring that. As we didn't remain gatherer primarily, so we ignored the wildlife. So we only stopped. Use them for our own purpose. We started exploiting them when we are in need, for to fulfill our own needs. We never counted them as part of our life. So with agriculture, developing and lots of things comes in and civilization growing, like we went to plain areas, we went to better areas, we created lots of farmlands, then cities came up and civilization developed. And with development of civilization, this nature get further squeezed. We started cutting forests. We started cutting forests for agricultural land. We started converting plain lands into cities, concretizing cities. We started polluting the air by making industries, by pursuing mining activities to extract minerals for our own use. So we started open cast mining. We changed the land surface, and then again the forests were destroyed. We destroyed ecosystems. There was a squeeze, actually the natural habitats were squeezed. They were shrinked actually. And then the life system that thrived once in the forest, those ecosystems and natural habitat, they were in danger. They couldn't find enough space to survive. So there the man human animal conflict started. They started encroaching into our land. We have been encroaching into their lands in a very faster pace. So that resulted in man-animal conflict. And by mining, by industrialization and everything, we polluted the air. We made the air toxic, though it is the essential thing we need to live, to breathe. We still ignored that and we made the air toxic. We released lots of effluents to make the water toxic. not only to make the water toxic, but you know, like to pollute the whole food system, to contaminate the plants, to contaminate the foods we get. And we started consuming contami we are despite knowing that we are consuming contaminated foods, we are more interested in increasing agricultural products. So we are again applying lots of chemicals in the to the soil to get more food. So we are contaminating the soil. Then we are again contaminating the groundwater. So you know, like whole system we have started contaminating, and it's almost contaminated by now. Everything we eat, every you know, the air we breathe, the water we drink, everything is contaminated. We are not getting anything pure today that nature has afforded us. So this is the situation now, and the, you know, like this has all happened because of our increasing interference with the nature. And like my previous speakers told, I just noted one or two points. So that is yeah, the first point I will say about Dr. Alokji said about Green Revolution. What did we do by you know bringing really Green Revolution to India? Yes, those days actually we had a food scarcity. India needed food to increase its food production, but to what level? To fulfill its needs or to export more? So our the fundamental objective is not limited to our requirements. It's beyond our requirements to, you know, like get more crop yield to fulfill our needs to and to do export to do business to earn revenue. And at what cost we achieve that? You see, we contaminated the soil. We made the soil, unfertile. We killed soil fertility, we killed microbes of soil microbes, and we started applying more and more chemicals to get the yield. By killing the soil, we have been gifted by the nature. By killing the fertility of nature, that you know, like itself, like the soil itself used to rejuvenate through natural processes. Like there are forests, actually, the leaves fall and they decompose to add nutrients to the soil. The soil has lots of microbes. The soil has specific vegetations in specific areas to decompose periodically and to make the soil fertile. Soil has its own, you know, like insect world to rejuvenate the soil periodically to make the soil fertile, to make the soil softer. So, what we did by applying lots of chemical fertilizers is we destroyed the world of insects that supported the soil fertility. We destroyed the world of microbes that helped the soil to revive, to you know, become fertile every periodically. And what we did, you know, like is we destroyed the surrounding ecosystems also. When the soil become unfertile, the waters get contaminated, it actually affects the surrounding ecosystems. We destroyed ecosystems. Plants didn't have enough flowering and fruits to support as you know like before. The ecosystem services actually declined. We didn't get the same support from nature as we used to get for centuries. As our forefathers used to get since centuries. So we hampered the ecosystem, hampered the ecosystem services. And when the ecosystem surrounding nature actually is affected and the soil infertility increased actually, the contamination of soil expanded. And what happened by that is climate change. when the local climate changed, the local rain patterns changed. Temperature increased, local temperatures. And when this happens, actually, you know, like the soil became more drier and the soil quality went, you know, like further downward. And then started the desertification. So now I have seen some places in Odisha's Balangir district and Western Odisha. In Odisha particularly is known to, you know, like ISRO has also pointed out that Western Odisha is in the process of desertification. It's desertifying faster. So the soil is become, you know, like the green surrounding are turning into brown surroundings. When the world is thinking to convert the brown into green, we are converting the green into brown. And this actually, when happens, actually the water retaining capacity of soil decreases. And you must see every river in India, you know, the water flow in every river in India is decreasing. Some of the rivers are in the state of dying. And when the water flow in rivers decreasing by naturally and by man-made efforts like building dams, constructing dams, barrages, and, you know, like restricting the water flow in the rivers, then the water flowing into the ocean started decreasing. Today, the sediment flow and water flow to the ocean has decreased a lot. And when that decreases, the accretion of deltas are decreasing. Coastal areas are submerging into sea. Coastal erosion is taking place. And with less of fresh water entering the ocean salinity in different areas is increasing, and many parts of the ocean are, you know, like experiencing a state of hypoxia with very less dissolved oxygen. And warmer water with increased salinity, you know, like usually results in decrease in dissolved oxygen. And there are researches that have found that Indian Ocean is gradually, and Bay of Bengal particularly, and Arvianchi, parts of Arvianchi are gradually becoming hypoxia regions. And then ocean, you know, regions of ocean becoming hypoxia regions, those aquatic ecosystems like aquatic animal world, aquatic plant world suffer a lot. And with increasing temperature in the ocean, or with increasing ocean warming, what happens is, you know, like fish growth is restricted. And fishes from warmer region are migrating to colder regions. So we do, you know, like the fish population in some regions are declining. And this fish population, again, you know, like, what we see is toxic algae are growing in the warmer oceans. And fishes actually consuming those toxic algae are becoming toxic to humans. We all know that, you know, 3-4 years back, there was ciguatera in Mangalore of Karnataka. Because of consuming some fishes, actually, they had taken those toxic algae. They are brought from Kenya and some places of the Indian Ocean, some parts of the Indian Ocean. And they, after consuming that, hundreds of people died in Mangalore and nearby areas, the fishing population. And world over, actually, lots of people are dying because of the, such diseases, because of consuming fishes that consume, that take those, you know, like toxic algae. So what happens is, like, the world is becoming more and more toxic day by day, and the food sources are also, you know, like, getting squeezed, and the whole system is breaking. Actually, once you know, like, the ocean will be polluted highly saline, maybe, you know, like, after that it will largely, and the pollution and the ecosystem destruction and the increasing temperature, climate change, they have influenced the major source of, you know, like, food production for India and Asian countries, that is the monsoon. So monsoon pattern is changing. The monsoon is largely being affected. When ocean warming takes place, the monsoon actually is becoming largely affected. And what in return we are getting is more of the cyclones. And now actually in land also, because of the like sea surface temperature is increasing, the land surface temperature is also increasing. Low pressure systems are, you know, like becoming more frequent in land surfaces also, that are attracting low pressure systems or cyclonic storms from the Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea to the Indian coasts. So India is becoming more vulnerable to cyclonic storms. So this is actually we have been doing in the name of development. And we say we are developed, we are more civilized than people living in the forest, like people living, you know, like in outreach areas and living with ecosystem. And we say such people, you know, mostly indigenous community people, as uncivilized people, people who do not know anything. But in fact, if you see, if you compare, actually we have a lot, many to learn from them. I frequently visit those places. I frequently meet people from indigenous communities. I study actually their way of life, their way of agriculture, and how they depend on nature. One of the two things actually I collected from there, I will like to cite here, that in their farming, like they have the hunger, they have do multi-cropping in one particular patch of land. They grow everything, and in one dangor, like the of the Kand tribal communities, they grow in 2-3 acres of land minimum 60 variety of crops, and up to 100 variety of crops they grow in that particular land over a period of 8-9 months, from upland paddy to millets, leaves, legumes, and tubers. Varieties of things they grow there, and you know, they start the cultivation, they start their farming from April, and they do the harvest up to February, month of February, March. So every time they get their produces from there, they thrive on that. And the major concept that actually these dangars are based on is, they say one dangar supports 10 families, not one family, the cultivator's family. What are those families? If you see that, it's very interesting. It's not only the cultivator, not only, you know, like the community, but it helps the insects thrive on that particular dangar, that particular farmland. Then the, you know, like from ants to the flies, then the birds, from everything, from spiders. So you know, like 10-13 varieties of things actually come to that, and they all have a share. What the tribal belief is, they all have a share, and that is the reason why they still do not apply chemical fertilizer, because they are, once they apply that, they are going to kill the cohabitative, you know, like they are cohabiting animals, cohabiting creatures, or the cohabiting nature, you can say. So they ask, who gave us the power to apply some fertilizer that will kill, you know, like the insects, kill the flies, kill the birds, kill the surrounding ecosystem? We do not have that power. Nature has gifted us everything. They are also gifted by nature. So we need to thrive, and they also need to thrive from there. And that alternatively actually give them a natural system of, you know, like pesticide control. When they grow crops, ultimately, you know, like automatically insects come. And when the insects come, other like the birds, the, you know, like spiders, they come and they, you know, like thrive on them. And the pollinators also visit their farm for, you know, like bees come for their honey, and they pollinate, they do pollinating works there. So they also provide service and they get benefits from the land also, from the farmland also. So this is actually the concept of cohabitation. And they protect the forest. It's actually they do not protect, but they, you know, like cohabit the forest also. They do not destroy the forest because the forest also provides them food. They get lots of nutrients from the forest. So they cannot imagine a life without the forest. Even if someone is not cultivating, not growing anything, he or she gets everything from the forest. From leaves, fruits, honey and everything. From all food and nutrients, he or she gets from the forest itself. So nature actually, you know, like even youth, today's youth also has not been inspired by our concept, but is following their concept. He said, when you try to put fertilizer, you know, like for higher yield, you are exploiting the nature. You are just killing the nature to make more profit. It's like, you know, like sucking blood from the mother instead of, you know, like consuming milk for mere, you know, for mere benefits or for economic produce, you know, being motivated by our greedy attitude, greedy instinct. So this is how they live actually. They don't, so, you know, like why they are forest, they are not custodians. They never think that. And I am very much opposed to that. We should never think to be the guardian of nature. We cannot be the guardian of nature. We have to cohabit with nature. We have to share the earth with nature. It's not, you know, like our right to nature, but we have to give equal right to nature. Though the process, as you mentioned, as Anujji mentioned, as Alokji mentioned, as Bharatiji mentioned, there have been some efforts, but they are not adequate. And don't think nature is dumb. Nature cannot speak. This is a very wrong concept. Everything we are facing today are the voices of nature. Nature speaks to us in its own language. We are facing cyclones. We are because we have destroyed nature, and we, you know, like encourage temperature rise. We encourage climate change. We destroyed forests. So nature is speaking in its own languages. Natural disasters happening. You know, nature speaks through that. Desertification is happening. Nature speaks through that. And we are still not, you know, very much concerned about that. We are still not heeding properly to the way nature is communicating with us. We need to do that. And to do that, we need to respect the, you know, rights of nature. We are nobody to, you know, like give the rights of nature. We just simply need to allow nature to enjoy its own rights. We just need to give space to nature to have its own rights. We have encroached upon its rights. We have encroached upon its rights on a very massive scale. We need to realize our mistake. We need to undo our wrongs. We don't need to, you know, like be the guardian of nature, and that will be the biggest wrong if we want to be, if we try to be the guardian of nature. Nature itself is the guardian. So we cannot be guardian of nature. So with this, actually, I will end my what I wanted to say. I just want to say, you know, in the last, that as Bhartiji and every other speaker actually highlighted by now, we are experiencing what a situation we can face because of degrading nature, because of destroying nature. The pandemic is one of the biggest examples that has taken over the whole mankind. So we need to, you know, like save nature. We need to share the earth with nature. We need to respect the rights of the nature, and I think that only can help man, you know, safety of mankind, and you know, like safety of the whole planet. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for joining the quest and sharing such informative sessions and views on the aspect, especially related to rights of nature and our increasing interference with nature, like our increasing use of chemicals leading to contamination of water life, and also how we are hampering the ecosystem services and turning the brown surroundings into green surroundings into brown surroundings, and how the nature is reacting back. Thank you, sir, for sparing your valuable time with us. Thank you so much.